friends and good afternoon to the friends who are in other countries. And it is indeed a great pleasure to be in this 66 Peter Morris Memorial, Peter Morris, this webinar. And I also had a very good interaction with Professor Peter Morris. In fact, he has offered me a fellowship in his center, but I could not go because I could not get leave at that time from the Sanjay Gandhi PGI. But we had many interaction in various meetings, and we always enjoyed talking to him and listening to his very, very interesting and educative lectures. Job is to talk about future of renal transplantation. You know, the predicting the future is very difficult. He who lives by crystal ball soon learns to eat ground glass. And it is far better to foresee even without certainly not to be foreseen at all. It is important, you may not see the future, but it is important to try to see what is going to come. And my disclaimer is, I am not an astrologer, but can predict the future based on ongoing scientific research. Let's see, when you want to see the future, you have to see what is the current status, where we are. If you see, there is a gross mismatch between demand and supply. The prevalence of end-stage renal failure is approximately 60 per 100,000 in India. So approximately 200,000 transplants are required yearly, but only we are doing around approximately 8,500 transplants. Most of the transplants are mostly done in Class A and Class B cities. Rural population need to travel to urban centers. 80% transplants are done in private healthcare. There are 200 transplant centers, but only 30 centers are there who are doing more than 50 transplants in a year. Mostly our pool is living related donors, but still we are doing deceased donor is around 10%, live donor is around 90%. Altruistic donation is very rare. Disease donor transplant is still in infancy in many of the states, especially in the northeast states. Small numbers of centers are doing ABO incompatible transplant and pair donation transplant. There is a ABO incompatible transplant is still not very popular because of the increased cost and reduced success rate. Pair donation transplant is being done only in center between because of the limitation in our legislature. Unless that points is that law is improved or new clause are added, it won't grow to a large number. Most of the donors are still in India are females, mainly mother, wife, and sisters. Marginal donor constitute 10% of the donor pool. National insurance is there, but only few patients have the coverage from there. Only those who have taken higher coverage. Most of the time, cost is borne by the patients. And not he only bear the cost of surgery, bears the cost of immunosuppression, all the complications, sickly and follow-up. So there is a very high economic burden on poor patients. Robotics are still not covered by the insurance. The training is also not a very well-structured training is happening all over the country. There are few large centers who are doing around 100 to 200 transplants where people are getting good exposure and getting training. There's few transplant fellowships are available, but there is no uniformity in training. There is no national guidelines. And in India, most of the transplants are done by urologists, but vascular surgeons and general surgeons are, in some places, even cardiac surgeons are also doing kidney transplants. Training of transplant coordinator was not very uncommon before, but now it has opened up and more transplant coordinators are getting trained. We don't have the central registry, but something is happening. And because there is no lack of registry, there is no standard SOPs. There is a poor public awareness regarding donation. There is a religious bias for donation and lack of administrative will to promote cadaveric organ donation. But the problem with the future is that it keeps turning into the present. So what's road so far? Our economy is improving, and our infrastructures are improving. More and more patients can afford the transplant now. There is a better hygiene, awareness, and healthcare structures have improved tremendously, especially in private sector. Now, the used to be the good hospitals only in major city, but now the good hospitals has gone into tier 2 and tier 3 cities. There are many good hospitals are there in even smaller cities run by the individual doctors and group of the doctors. Now the super specialty care is also available in smaller cities. Most of the transplant drugs, whether it is for rejection or induction, are now manufactured in India, and their cost has gone down tremendously, and government has also capped their cost. So these drugs have become affordable to most of our patients. Now we have better dialysis in majority of the cities. There used to be only one AIIMS in Delhi, but now there is 15 operational AIIMS and 8 new AIIMS are about to start. There used to be only 100-150 medical colleges. Now there is 550 medical colleges. There are more than 200 transplant centers across the country, and more are being added every year. Now the government has created NOTO, SOTO and ROTO. There is a NOTO registry which is collecting data from all over the country and distributing the cadaveric organs to respective hospitals. The training of transplant coordinators is going very well, and most of the transplant centers have coordinated. Like my hospital, there are now 5 coordinators, one for lung, one for liver, 2 for kidneys, 1 for heart. The disease donor program picking up especially started from south, then gone to west, and is happening some part of the north also, and I'm sure it will spread to the east and northeast also. Role of NGOs, many NGOs, Mohan Foundation, JetCCC, Jivandan are also working, which are also helping in this program. The Indian story is our growth is very diverse. We grow in a very unplanned way in all the direction, but we grow. And we have very good facilities. Like we have a very good hospitals which can match to any Western hospitals. Some of the medical institutions are at par with any institution around the world. So what I am trying to say that with the time, there'll be more transplants will be done because there is more transplant centers, more hospital, more facilities, more trained people, more transplant coordinator. There'll be more disease donation will happen, and more ABO incompatible pair donation transplant marginal donors are done. So all these will lead to, you'll see that every year the transplant number will keep on increasing, and maybe we'll become the biggest transplant center after the China. Insurance base is also increasing. Government has also launched Ayushman Bharat. Nowadays, transplant patients are getting relief from the PM and CM relief funds. The many PSUs and private companies are also paying for their employees. NGOs are also helping. So all these things leads to more number of transplant, and it is going to grow. So very soon you will see the number of transplant will be crossing around next few years. It will be between 12,000 to 15,000. So what is the future direction? It is very confusing, but future, nobody waits, time never waits for anybody, and it's keep moving. So what I could see that there'll be a future direction will be in four ways. we'll have a better tolerance. So once we do the kidney, kidneys are going to work for many years. So there'll be a lot of efforts are being done for organ regeneration. There is a lot of research is going on xenotransplantation. Bioartificial kidneys are available. And there is a now, you know, that machine perfusion strategy has also evolved. Initially, it was used to be, we used to kidney store into the cold storage, but it can work up to 48 hours. After that, perfusion is not good. But then hypothermic machine perfusion has come. Now, normothermic machine perfusion has come. So even if you can take out the marginal kidney, put it on the machine, you can see how good is the kidney, whether it will work or it will not work. And you can keep this kidney for longer period till you get a proper HLA match. So all these things are going to improve our outcome and more transplants will be done and more marginal kidney can be utilized. Transplant tolerance, you know, from King College London, Robert lecturer, has done a lot of work. He used the term, he used the humanized mouse model. He genetically modified regulatory T cells, target their attention on transplant, make immune system selectively blind to transplanted organ while continue to protect person from infections and cancers. And some interesting research has been, basically it is the TRAC therapy. And patients are especially, the cells were generated using a 2 weeks co-culture of recipient lymphocyte with irradiated donor cells in the presence of anti-CD86 monoclonal antibodies, initially used in liver transplant. Clinical studies in kidney transplant is ongoing using autologous polyclonal or donor antigen expanded TRAC cells. TRAC therapy seems feasible and safe, but data remains preliminary and preclinical. Further studies are ongoing for factors such as dose and timing of TRAC infusions, immunosuppression regimes, and long-term suppression. There are a few interesting studies have come up, and I think there are more research is going on where the donor bone marrow transfusion was done along with the kidney transplantation. And the whole idea was to create chimerism. And there is some success has achieved. Some patients have gone out of the immunosuppressive drugs. Some remained on immunosuppressive drugs. Sometimes bone marrow transplantation and kidney transplantation was done together. And sometimes bone marrow transplant was done 4 months later. So more research will occur in this direction and to develop the tolerance so that once kidney is put, they can grow for many years without, and then since immunosuppression will be minimal, risk of infection and cancer will also be low. Now, another thing is the regenerative medicine. Here, there is a lot of work done by Professor Mauro Ziaka. He's a cardiologist from King College, London. Here, we manipulate and enhance body capacity to repair itself. We induce pluripotent stem cells, iPS cells, normal cells, reprogram to stem cell state, the possibility to repair damaged organ, and you can grow the damaged organs into the original organs, or it can take care of the whatever insult has happened. Now, this is also going in various directions. One is that nephron progenitor cells, their glomeruli and renal tubules generated in vitro from human-induced pluripotent stem cells. The induced nephron progenitors were recombined with spinal cord feeders and cultured for 9 days. There is another nice method here. Nephron progenitors were injected into fetal nephrogenic zone of different animal species, including cloned pigs. And following nephron generation, donor recipient cells were mixed in the regenerated kidney and transplanted. Like here, when they did it, that organ has developed but since there was no drainage system, like this started ballooning up and urine is being collected. So what they did, they tried to join the recipient ureter in that so that urine can drain it. So these are the initial efforts, and probably more things will happen, and in future we may be able to regenerate the organ or region from the stem cells. We can generate a new kidneys. The genotransplantation is going for last many years, and there is a sufficient progress has been made. They have overcome the hyperacute rejection, and the kidneys have been working for few weeks to few months. But then there was a problem of infections in the recipients, so the trial has started, but it is going to restart again. And basically what they are doing, it is deletion of pig genoantigens and insertion of protective human transgenes. So you can grow a pig and remove their unwanted genes and insert the human genes in that, and then the organ will be similar to the human organs where it can be transplanted to the patients. And the patient gene can be studied, which can be injected into the pig genes. So a lot of research are going, and I am hope in next coming years, we may be able to grow the kidney for a respective recipients. So genografting has a lot of advantage because there is an unlimited supply of donor organs. Organs available electively, even when required. So there is no urgency. We can grow the organ, and when it is ready, we can do the transplantation. And then we can avoid this life-related donation because it is unnecessary. A person is going for major operation. And we can also, when we are growing the organs, we can also screen for all the known infections and microorganisms and take care of it so that when the organ, we get a healthy organ. And organ can also be tailored to the requirement of that particular recipient. So the recipient gene and antigens can be studied, and they can be the animals. It can be modified, and then organ can be grown, and then it can be transplanted. But there is one major problem, is the danger of transmission of zoonotic disease. Like we see that now the coronavirus has gone all over the world. So that danger will always be there. Now there's another things are happening is the wearable kidney. Here you can wear a jacket, and in the jacket there'll be a renal assisted device and extracorporeal circuit, and it will be connected to the AV fistulas, and there'll be a bioartificial renal epithelial cell systems and extracorporeal filtration unit with renal epithelial cells seeded into the porous ducts. You can wear this jacket, you can move around, you can do your work, and once the dialysis is over, you can take off your jacket. So you don't have to be hooked to the dialysis machine, and this jacket is working as a wearable dialysis machine. So this will become a more friendly dialysis jacket which people may use in future. You all must have heard this bioartificial kidney, which is the size of a cup of coffee, and it combines design, eliminates, inspired by the nature and other that directly incorporate human cells. It uses power of the patient's own heart to pump blood through the filter. Ultrafiltrate passed through the bioreactor filled with renal tubular cells. And in the it is in the first stage, and the hemofilter made from the silicon nanopore membranes with slit shaped tiny filter pores energy supplied by the patient's own blood pressures. Silicon is fatigue resistant. Surface is modified with chemistry and topography to optimize it for blood compatibility and filtration. One or two molecules, thick films, are applied on surface of biomembrane to prevent protein absorption and blood clot formations. And in the second stage, the bioreactor is filled with cultured kidney cells from the donor kidney. These renal tubule cells reabsorb most of the useful components such as salt, sugar, and water, and back into the renal tubular cell harvested from donor kidney and cultured to supply multiple bioreactors. Encased in silicon membrane, the kidney cells are isolated from body immune systems and patient does not require any immunosuppression. And so this is a very interesting development, and it is happening in two places, in California and Texas, and everybody is waiting to see what will happen in future. And we don't know what will, like, we have to do the operation as we do now and re-implant this machine into artery as vein, and there will be tube going to the bladder, or it will be some different systems. But I'm not very sure what will happen, because whenever these tubes are there, there is always an infection and clotting, and urine is very lethargic. Whatever tube you put in the urine, there is always a stone formation, and then you might have to replace the tube. Now, another thing is happening is 3D printing of human organs. So now you can print the human organs in the lab, and then you can use it for the transplant. This is a famous doctor, urologist from Dr. Anthony Atala. He is doing a lot of work on artificial organs. And it is very difficult to understand what they are doing, but it looks like that they are creating a scaffold by 3D printing and then putting the cells, cultured cells in that, and putting the cultured media all around, so these culture cell will grow in this scaffold and take the shape of the organ. But these things are happening, and future we may print the organ as and when required. That's how it is being done, but it is difficult to understand how it will take the living shape of a living organ. And with the recent development of the 3D printing, cell positioning and material deposition in organ manufacture has seen a greater control, and there is some progress has been made, and we'll still wait to see what happens in futures. So future is very elusive. Maybe in future, end-stage renal disease may be prevented, halted, or modified. We may not need dialysis or transplantation. And maybe it will be end of our professional career. And maybe it will develop like that, and when patient comes to it, we can say, yes, we have kidneys. Do you want to buy it, or you want to lease it? Or how long do you want to have kidney? And we can prepare a kidney for you. And there will be people who have artificial organs like heart, kidney, liver. And as and when they can, after a few years, they will get it replaced. Maybe once we do a genotransplant, to lighter more note, have you heard about the man who got transplanted with the dog's kidney? He needs to lift his legs to pee. So don't worry, guys. Future is good. And hopefully, we'll see a very different things in future. Maybe we may not be doing transplant, doing some better things. Thank you.